Well, good morning. Voice sounds a little better than the last time I was here. I had some of the college kids tell me I sounded like Batman, and my son said I sound like the Wolverine, and I just got a lot of compliments. It was really sweet. I went to the Shepherd's Conference last week and was greatly blessed. Gathering in California, people from 64 different countries as we gathered to learn the Word of God and worship together, and it was just a great blessing to my soul. And just a special thank you to Nick Decker, who preached in my absence, and I just was so encouraged with how God's working in his life and growing him up, and it's just beautiful to watch. And then to meet little baby Hudson, thank you for bringing him up. I have a son named Taylor, and we named him after the same person, and we're praying those two young men will take the China for the gospel of Jesus Christ. So Lord willing. Well, next week I'm going to be in Carolina officiating at a wedding. So this morning is what a preacher calls freelancing. I get to preach on whatever I want. I don't want to start a new book and then leave you guys. So there's so much freedom and sometimes too much freedom in trying to discern and figure out what would that be. But I believe the Lord has led me to Genesis. So if you'll turn to Genesis chapter 15, we're going to look at Abraham this morning because he just intrigues me so much. As I look at the Old Testament and the New Testament, I see him as one of the central figures for God's promise to bless us by grace. It is through his seed, God tells him that all the nations will be blessed. And we're living in the fullness of this promise that was made 4,000 years ago on a daily basis, where more stars are added to his spiritual descendants as they call upon the name of the Lord day in and day out. Abraham is the father of blessing being bestowed by grace through faith. And then as we watch the rest of the Bible unfold from this promise that God makes, the law is later given. And he says the law wasn't changing that promise. It didn't nullify it. It came to serve the promise. It came to show the holiness and the character of God, that it would lead us to this gospel, this promise that Abraham was given by God. And it's so beautiful that I want to spend a Sunday just kind of doing a bird's eye view of this great promise of this man of faith. We have three major religions in the world today that are built upon Abraham: the Muslims, Judaism, and Christianity. You get Abraham and you really get the whole unfolding of Jesus Christ and the gospel. And so there's been a lot of attack in the last 150 years upon Abraham, this thing called higher criticism, and they begin to look at the text and reanalyze and say it was nothing more than mythology. Abraham wasn't real. He was kind of a parabolic lesson. And you'd begin to gut the entire Bible and miss what this literal historical figure teaches us and the unfolding mystery of God's plan. And so I would like us to pray and ask God to teach us in his word this morning. I think we're in for a great blessing. I've been overwhelmed studying Genesis 15 this week. And so I pray that he'll meet us in a very special way in the Word of God this morning, and it'll indeed be worship for the saints of God. So let's go to our God. Father, we come before you, and I just think how the seraphim cover their faces, their eyes, and their feet when they're in the presence of such holiness. And God, I can never get over that we now can stand in this holiness, blameless with great joy. God, I thank you for the gospel of Jesus Christ. I thank you that you can take sinners and you can take our sin and put it on another, a substitute, and there punish him in our place. And you can take a perfect righteousness of your own son and wrap us in it. And now we can be not guilty and we can be adopted and be sons of God, sons and daughters of the living God. And so we thank you for the gospel of grace. That is why we gather this morning. And as we look at the foundation of it this morning, I pray that every heart would be overwhelmed and blessed by what is to be taught in Genesis 15. So God, I pray by your Spirit that you would open up these words and you would illumine every mind and heart to see this in a way that their hearts would be inflamed and stirred, and it would activate their wills to be obedient to the living God. So Lord, use these words this morning for your name's sake, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Genesis 15, I want to give you a little context. It's kind of a beautiful context. It's the whole universe coming into being, God speaking it into being. Adam and Eve then, Adam is created and Eve is created from the rib. And then there's that the fall where the enemy comes and tempts Adam and Eve. And they take all of mankind down with them. And at that point, God makes a promise to bring about restoration through Adam's seed. And then we see sin now because of the fall. It begins to spread through all of mankind in Genesis 6:5. Every intent of the thought now of mankind was only evil continually. The fall did great damage to the human race. And so God finally comes and he brings a preacher of righteousness, Noah, and the flood comes and it wipes out the earth. And now we are beginning to learn how God is going to work and bring about this promise, this new people from every tribe, tongue, and nation, and a new people for himself. The father of this new humanity that God is now going to create is going to be through Abraham. And we come and we see Abraham introduced, and he's an idolater. God chooses him, and he calls him out by for this great purpose that God had for him to use Abraham in such a mighty and powerful way. Listen to Genesis 12:1. Now the Lord said to Abram, go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great. And so you shall be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And so Abram went forth as the Lord had spoken to him, and Lot went with him. And he left everything that he knew, and he went to follow the Lord's calling. Abraham's journey has been somewhat difficult. He's had pressures from kings. He lied about his wife, and he was almost killed. There was strife between his herdsmen and Lot's, and so they separated. And in chapter 14 now, there's been battles against some leaders of other tribes and groups. Now, Abraham may be fearing retaliation from those groups that he just conquered. But one thing for sure now, as we come to chapter 15, there appears to be some fear or some doubt or just cloudy understanding with Abraham. The promises that God gave to Abraham as he set out and left everything, there's no tangible expressions of them in his life at all right now. There's nothing to show of the promises of God to encourage him and to support him up. There are no evidences that God is keeping his promise. And so am I just a fool, trusting in the bare promise of God with nothing right now by sight? And so here is the temptation of life that most of us will face, and dare I say all of us, that is to doubt. That's this battle of the sin that so easily entangles us, the sin of unbelief. To doubt that God is infinite goodness and all he does and his providences for us as believers are for our good in the conformity of Jesus Christ. So there has been a time of waiting between promise and fulfillment. The time where we must live by faith in the promise of God. Even when everything around us is preaching the opposite, there's an obstacle then that every one of us must overcome, and that will be those seasons and those battles with doubt. And we will struggle, and there'll be times where we won't see the manifestations and what God is doing, and all we'll be having is dark, hard providences, and there can be doubt that begins to creep in. And so if you're sitting here this morning with some doubt, I'm going to show you how God deals with doubt. Look with me in Genesis 15:1. After these things, after the delay and fulfillment, when do you want promises to happen? We want them now. We want them to happen right now, and there's a delay, and the kings might be retaliating. So after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. And this is a phrase that we're very familiar with in the Old Testament, especially the prophets. You hear it again and again. The word of the Lord came to Isaiah. It came to Jeremiah. Yet in the Pentateuch, we don't have this phrase one time. It is only here that Abraham gets a vision and a clear voice and the revelation from God. Excuse me. Do not fear, Abram, for I am a shield to you, and your reward will be great. Don't be afraid, Abram. I'm a shield. I'm your protector. I will take care of you. Your reward is going to be great. Isn't that amazing to get a word like that from God? So how does Abraham respond? Does he just say, thank you, Lord, that fixes everything? Your reward shall be very great. Well, that's great, but there's just a little bit of a problem here. Where's that child that you promised? I need seed to be blessed and to have the descendants as great as the sand on the seashore. Look in verse 2. Abraham said, O Lord God, what will thou give me since I'm childless? And the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus. And so here we are. His faith, it's not gone, but there is some doubt or maybe some wonder. God, how are you going to do this? I don't have any children still. 75. The heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus. Is that going to be it? In those days, that's who would get your inheritance if you didn't have children. So is that how you're going to do it? Through this guy? And Abram said in verse 3, since thou hast given no offspring to me, one born of my house is my heir. So is that how you will do this, God? Well, verse 4, behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this man will not be your heir, but one who shall come from your own body, he shall be your heir. And he took him outside, and he said, now look toward the heavens and count the stars, if you're able to count them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And so all of these stars on that beautiful night, Abraham, your descendants are going to be more than these stars if you could count them. And Abraham's response to what God shared with him is really the whole Bible in a verse. Abraham then, it says, he believed in the Lord and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. And that is the whole gospel, is that God is telling him, I'm going to bless you through seed. We'll see later in Galatians, through the seed that I'm going to send, which will be Jesus Christ. But here's how all the blessings are going to come, and I'm going to do it, and I'm going to be the one who brings forth children, and I'm going to be the one who will bring the blessing upon you. And Abraham has no reason to believe other than the word of God, and he just believes the sheer word of God, and it's reckoned to him as righteousness. God now takes the full righteousness of him, and he puts it to Abraham's account, and now Abraham is declared righteous before the living God. Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. So out of the gate, what I want you to see is that one of the greatest verses in the whole Bible, the forming of the Abrahamic covenant, there's doubt sitting in the midst of this. We're going to battle with this stuff until the very end. Yet in our text, what I want us to see and learn this morning is how to battle it and how to handle it. That there's a battle nonetheless, and how do we fight this battle that all of us have from time to time? Here is the father of faith. He's left everything to follow after God's call. He's had clear revelations from God. How do you think we're going to do? This is the father of faith here struggling. And so just a few thoughts, and then we'll proceed in the text. But I just was thinking a little bit on doubt this week. And considering the liberals, really what they're teaching is that everything is built on doubt. You can't be certain about any cardinal truths. Relativism's alive and well. They're cynical. And everything must have some doubt to it. My voice hasn't healed up all the way, has it? We're going to get through this by the grace of God. Conservatives, doubt is complete evil and failure. You can't even talk about doubt. So what happens is you can't really be authentic and ask good questions and talk openly in the church of God. And so what we do is we need to be able to come, like in this text this morning, and watch how God deals with doubt. So I want you to come and communicate doubts and express them, and we'll go to the truth of God's word and heal them and deal with them. And so that there's a way to deal with doubt. And God leads Abraham right out of it. And so at Southside Bible Church, doubters are welcome, but let's look at the truth so that you might become Abrahams and be children of faith. And so in this passage, we're going to see two components that are bringing about doubt for Abraham. In verses 2 through 3, I have no children. How do you have this many inheritance and children and all of these things if you don't have any of your own? And then in verse 8, I don't have any land. All I see is a bunch of Canaanites possessing the promised land. I don't have any. At this point, I possess none. And so the first way that God begins to deal with Abraham's doubt is through revelation. And he tells him, I'm a shield to you, Abraham. I'm your shield, and your reward will be very great. God communicates to him. He gives Abraham an illustration. Go out and look at the stars, and your descendants are going to be just like those stars. And so the question is, can I trust God? That is at the root of all doubt. Pastor, we've spent 7 weeks on Psalm 23, and we learned the beauties and the glories of the good shepherd and trusting him and being led by him. I loved it. But how do I just trust him in light of everything that I'm facing here this morning? It just seems like unfulfilled promises, the world's winning. I just am battling in so many ways. How can I be certain? How do I fight my doubt? So in verse 8, oh Lord God, how shall I know that I shall possess it? In verse 9, God said to him, bring me a 3-year-old heifer and a 3-year-old female goat. So give me a goat and a 3-year-old ram and a turtle dove and a young pigeon. And then he brought all these to him and cut them in two and laid each half opposite the other. But he did not cut the birds, and the birds of prey came down upon the carcasses, and Abraham drove them away. And so I'm struggling with all these promises, and I'm trying to see, God, how are you going to fulfill them? And you say, just get a bunch of animals and cut them up? Why? This seems so strange to us, doesn't it? But Abraham knew exactly what God was doing. God is making a covenant with Abraham. And when we think of a covenant in our day and age, we think more of like a written code is what comes to our mind. So I was just, you know, if you hired a contractor, you hire those guys to put in a walkway. And you talk over, what do you want? Here's how we want it. Here's the kind of stamped concrete, all these things. And the contractor then gives you a quote of what it would cost. And then if he pulled out a heifer and a goat and a ram and cut them in half on your porch, you'd be like, this guy's not going to work on my house. But the bottom line is, if he just starts working on it and he comes back and says, Ken, your bill is going to be $20,000 more than I said. And you're going to be like, what? Well, you had no contract, so you're stuck. What we do here in our land then is we have written contracts. And both parties sign them in agreement. And if anything in that contract is not done by the contractor, he's liable for damages and he'll have to pay for it or he'll have to finish it the right way, or at least in theory. I'm sure there's stories here that didn't work out that way. But that's the theory. And so a contract brings peace to the one signing it, that they can't just change it and do whatever they want and bring extra charges. The contractor signs it, and there will be a penalty if I don't do what I say. Yet in Abraham's day, it was not done that way. And I like the way they did it back there better. Abraham knew exactly what God was doing. He was cutting a covenant with him. And what God was asking Abraham to do was to enter into a covenant. And so Abraham gets these animals. And what's interesting, these five animals that are listed are the same five listed in Leviticus for blood sacrifices. He goes and he gets them and he cuts them. And he makes this perfect aisle where he cuts the animal in half. And you put a half on each side of the aisle. And then the aisle would be large enough for the covenant parties then to walk between these pieces, and then they would make a covenant together. This was called cutting a covenant. And so both parties would walk through, and they would make a covenant that if I do not do what I say, may I be like these animals. May God dismember me if I don't keep my covenant. And so what a powerful picture this morning. I think this could really help contractors from being crooked and unjust if we did it this way in America. And I also thought it might help at weddings. Could you imagine just cutting up these animals and having a bride and groom walk through them as they leave. If I don't keep my covenant, may God do this to me. I think the divorce rate would go down. So Abraham knew that God was entering into a covenant with him. He's cutting a covenant. He's showing Abraham the seriousness of what God is saying he will do and the absolute certainty of it. I'm going to put my seal upon this covenant, says God. This is so that you will know, Abraham, I will fulfill my covenant with you. And if I don't, may I be dismembered. Abraham, you will inherit the land. You will be the father of a great nation. From you, the true seed, not some servant or Ishmael. The Messiah, the seed, will come from your loins. I make a covenant with you that this will happen. I want you to listen to Jeremiah 34. I will give the men who have transgressed my covenant, who have not fulfilled the words of the covenant which they made before me, God, when they cut the calf in two and passed between its parts, the officials of Judah and the officials of Jerusalem, the court officers and the priests, and all the people of the land who passed between the parts of the calf, and I will give them into the hand of their enemies and into the hands of those who seek their life, and their dead bodies shall be for food for the birds of the sky and the beasts of the earth. God is cutting a covenant with Abraham, and Abraham is waiting now for God to come and cut the covenant. But God doesn't appear, and Abraham has to wait. And so the morning passes, and the afternoon passes, and the darkness descends upon the land, and there's still no God. And the birds of the prey keep coming, and they're vultures upon us, and they just keep coming on the carcasses. And so I see that there are times when we want God to appear, and all we see is the birds of the prey. But look with me now in verse 12. Now when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and behold, terror and great darkness fell upon him. And God said to Abram, know for certain that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, where they will be enslaved and oppressed 400 years. But I will also judge the nations whom they will serve, and afterwards they will come out with many possessions. And as for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace, and you shall be buried at a good old age. And in the fourth generation, they shall return here, for the iniquity of the Amorite is not yet complete. And so Abraham falls asleep. A great terror and darkness falls upon him. And then in verses 14 through 16 is this great prophecy that you're gonna be led into bondage for 400 years, and that's going to be that Egyptian bondage that's going to come, and then God's going to deliver them, and they're going to plunder the Egyptians, and they're going to take all of their riches. So here is Abraham struggling with fulfillment right now. He's struggling a little bit with doubt and understanding how God's going to work. And he tells them the answer, there's going to be 400 years of bondage, and you're going to die at a good old age, but I will fulfill my promise to you. So maybe not the answer he was looking for in his depression and his darkness of soul. You're not going to get to see this. The Canaanite sin, here's the patience of God, is the fullness of it hasn't come yet before judgment. So the fullness of their iniquity hasn't come yet where they're going to be judged. There's the patience of God. And you won't see the land in your lifetime, Abraham, but it will come. And God's going to make a covenant right now with Abraham. So look with me in verse 17. And it came about when the sun had set that it was very dark. And behold, there appeared a smoking oven and a flaming torch which passed between these pieces. The sun had set now and it's very dark. There appeared all of a sudden a smoking oven and a flaming torch. Isn't that kind of interesting? What is that? Those are the same words to describe Mount Sinai when the Lord descended upon it. And then think of the Shekinah glory that led Israel out of bondage and led them through the wilderness all those years. We're told that during the day, what was it? That the manifestation of God was a cloud of smoke, a smoking oven. And during the night, it was a pillar of fire, which would be a flaming torch. And so this night, right now with Abraham, this is the very presence of God that has been manifested to Israel, the Shekinah. These are the emblems of God's glory presence. And now they come and they go through the slain animals. So cool. And this appears, and it goes down the aisle, and it passes between the cut-up animals. And God says, in this covenant, I will give your descendants the land. And the rest of the list here in Genesis 15 is all the Canaanites. I will give you Canaan. And so Abraham, if I don't bless you through your seed and make it great as much as the sand on the seashore, your seed will come the Messiah, and there's going to be land and all these promises in the Abrahamic covenant. If I don't do it, may I be cut off. May I be cut up. May my immortality become mortality. May my infinitude become finite. May I be destroyed if I don't keep this covenant and this promise to you. God has made a covenant that he will keep his promise to Abraham and to his seed. I want you to listen to 2,000 years later, the writer of Hebrews. In Hebrews 6, he said, when God made the promise to Abraham, since he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself, saying, I will surely bless you and I will surely multiply you. And thus Abraham, having patiently waited, he obtained the promise that God made. Men swear by one greater than themselves, and with them an oath was given as confirmation as an end of every dispute. But in the same way, God, desiring even more to show to the heirs of the promise, you and I, the unchangeableness of his purpose, he interposed it with an oath, in order that by two unchangeable things, which it's impossible for God to lie, and a covenant, we may have strong encouragement. We who have fled for refuge and laying hold of the hope set before us in Jesus Christ. This hope we have as an anchor of the soul. It's a hope both sure and steadfast, and one which enters within the veil where Jesus entered as a forerunner for us, having become a high priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. And what this should do for doubt is unbelievable. God has made an oath. He's made a covenant. He has sealed his promise, and he said, I will keep this. And it's to bring this security, this unchangeableness that God can't lie, he can't break an oath, he can't break a covenant, that I will bless everyone who flees to Jesus Christ by faith and beholds him. That you can be dogmatic and steadfast. If you're doubting this morning, I want you to look again to this God who made an oath and covenant to bless us in his son. God will keep his covenant. But as I was thinking through this week, and if I were honest with you, I heard one preacher talk about this week. He said, my doubt is not so much with whether God will keep his part, but my doubt is I'm more worried about me. That makes sense. I'm not struggling as much that God's going to keep his part. I'm just struggling more, will I keep my part? I seem to be the weak part of the equation. I'm the weakest link in the chain. Will I keep my part? And that has way more problem than God keeping his promise. And so much of my doubt arises from considering my end, my weakness, and my struggles. That's where most of us battle as we consider and look at that. And there's something very important about this text that God gave to Abraham that I do not want you to miss this morning. And as you look at it, I want you to notice who doesn't walk between the animals. Who doesn't walk in between these slain, cut-up animals? It's very interesting. Both parties were to walk between those animals and make a covenant. And there's only one who walks through this, and it's the torch and the oven. It's the very presence of God that walks through this. Abraham does not. God is the only one that walks between these animals. This covenant is based on God alone. Abraham, I will bless you. Whether I fail or you fail, I will pay the penalty. I will absorb the cost for both of us. This is what we call a one-sided covenant. If I fail, I'll be torn apart. If you fail, I will be torn apart. Your failures, your doubt, Abraham, saying your wife is your sister, are not going to get in the way of me blessing you. And I want you to hear that this morning. Your failures are not going to get in the way of God blessing you. What a covenant. Have you ever heard anything like it? It's been about 2,000 years after this promise was made to Abraham. There were 400 years of darkness in between the testaments where there was no prophecies, nothing. It was just a cold, dark, apostate season. There was no word from a prophet or God. And then all of a sudden, something absolutely amazing happened. An angel appears and tells a virgin something in Luke 1. The angel comes and says to Mary, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you're going to conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. And he will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." And Mary later goes to see her relative, Elizabeth. And upon arriving, she goes into the Magnificat. And she says, "My soul exalts the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior." Mary needed to be saved. "For he has regard for the humble state of his bondslave. For behold, from this time on, all generations are going to count me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is upon generation after generation, star after star, toward those who fear him. He's done mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who were proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, and he has exalted those who were humble. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent away the rich empty-handed. He has given help to Israel, his servant, in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever." Here's the remembering of God's promise to Abraham to bless the nations through his seed. 33 years later from that, Jesus hung on a cross and darkness enveloped the land. In Isaiah 53:6, it says he was cut off from the land of the living. Your sins will not get in the way of God blessing you through his seed. I want you to listen to Galatians 3 later, what Paul wrote. "Even so, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness," as we've seen in our text. "Therefore, be sure that it is those who are of faith who are sons of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, 'All the nations shall be blessed in you.'" The gospel. "So then those who are of faith are blessed with Abraham, the believer. For as many as are of the works of the law are under a curse." Everyone who tries to walk through that covenant on their own are under a curse. "For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law to perform them.' Now that no one is justified by the law before God is evident, for the righteous shall live by faith. However, the law is not of faith. On the contrary, who practices them shall live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree,' in order that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith." So I pray that you would bring your doubts this morning to the beauty and the wonder of it all. That is what all of history was teaching and what all of history was moving to. Abraham, you failed. You can't keep this covenant. God has done what he said he would do. By faith, we are sons of Abraham. And the conditions of the covenant, God has fulfilled in his son. He has kept it. And even our transgressions of the covenant, where we have failed to keep the law, Jesus was dismembered and killed in our place for our breaking of this covenant. Isn't that a beautiful promise? I pray that we see the glory and the beauty of what God has done in this covenant. And so as I close out, I just want to address just a couple people before. I want to start, if you've come in here this morning and you're not of the faith of Abraham, you're just kind of an unbeliever and you just keep wandering around and you try to clean yourself up and you start coming to church for a while, you leave, your whole life is just, it's not the life of faith. And so you keep trying. You've never surrendered to Christ and you have true doubt. And you have true unbelief, and you'll keep looking, what about dinosaurs? What about this? What about that? Global warming? And you just keep trying to find every reason to doubt, and yet there's something within you that you know, and you keep coming back again and again. And so I want you to really hear this clearly. Every other religion in this world makes you walk through the pieces. Every religion says there's something that you must do to appease God, to find acceptance with him. You've got to walk through the pieces. And you're going to keep looking for, what do I have to do? How do I fix myself? How do I get better? How do I get God to love me? And everything is walk through the pieces. Walk through the pieces. You got to do this to get God's favor. If I do enough, then I will know finally. The whole Reformation, as we celebrate 500 years, was based on a man named Martin Luther who tried that. And he finally died and he looked to the faith of Abraham and saw Jesus as the seed, as the answer to righteousness. I can't give it. I can't walk through the pieces. I got to look to the one who did. Then there's the one who wrote the book of Galatians, Paul, who tried the same thing. He tried harder than anybody to walk through the pieces and keep the law to get right with God. You will never come through that way to God. That is the glory of the gospel. God has promised to do it all through his seed, Jesus Christ. And as he hung up on the cross, he said, "It is finished. I did everything necessary to keep the covenant. I fulfilled every jot and tittle of righteousness, and I took the penalty for all of your unrighteousness. It's finished. The covenant, God has walked through it so that now he can bless you as children of God. It's finished." Hold out an empty hand this morning with nothing in it. Quit looking to religion, to your own merits, your own work, your own efforts. I want you to just stop and look to Jesus Christ alone and believe upon him and be saved. And Abraham believed God and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. And if you will this morning believe God, what he has said in Christ, he will reckon it to you as righteousness. Look and believe. Follow the Father of faith. Lay hold of Jesus Christ this morning. And for Christians, I think the longer I live, what that anchor, he says, is that faith, that hope is an anchor. And I think so many of us throw our anchor down, and that anchor will do you no good unless it lodges into the rock, unless it catches something. You'll just keep drifting all of your life. And I just think that there are some of you here who you've come to faith in Christ, but you're not anchoring on that. And you're sitting here worried, trusting other things, not relying on Jesus. You got your hope in this and in that. If God will just do this with my children or give me this health. And you're fixing your hope on everything other than this forerunner who's entered into the veil. And it's this anchor that we have of our soul. And so I want you to quit doubting, looking for hope and life and anything other than the seed who has come and kept it all. And may we build a life only on Christ and to look to him and to anchor our souls on this. And you'll quit wandering and flapping and moving with every wind of doctrine and every bit of the world getting you to conform to it. You'll quit moving all over the place. And you'll find this steadfast rock in Jesus Christ. So this morning, will you look at the seed and be blessed in believing the bare promise of God to bless you in Christ Jesus? Will you build a life of faith on this? Be not unbelieving, but be believing. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we come before you and I thank you for the beauty of this covenant. Lord, I thank you that the Father would be willing you would walk right through those pieces, Lord, that you would make a covenant, that you would be dismembered if you do not keep what you promised to Abraham. There's just nothing more steadfast or solid that we can build our life and our eternity on than an oath and a covenant made by our very God. Lord, we thank you that we can die on this. We can actually put our head in a noose or chopped a chopping block, being killed or martyred for this truth because we can die on it. Lord, we can die on it and we can live on it. And I thank you for the security of it. I pray, let us not be doubters. Let us not be looking at the world and all the things going on and not be believing. Lord, let us look again to this covenant. Let us look again to you. The cure for doubt is your covenant that you have made now, where Jesus Christ takes wine and says, this is the blood of my new covenant. That you have sealed this covenant with the blood of your own Son. Lord, he was shred and torn apart because we couldn't keep our end of the covenant. And I thank you that you kept your end by sending your own Son to be a curse in our place. God, we love this gospel. It is glorious and it is beautiful. Let every doubting heart look again at Christ. Let them gaze upon him this morning and be glad. Lord, lift our hearts. Let this be the center of all of our life and everything that we do. Oh God, thank you for this promise that you have made to us. I thank you for the word of God. I thank you for the beauty of it. Lord, let every heart be encouraged in Christ now this morning. And I pray again, any unbeliever, God, let that journey of doubt be done this morning. Something so beautiful that has been done for them. God, let them quit looking to their own strength and their own moral resolve and their own wisdom. Let them gaze upon Jesus Christ hanging on a cross in their place this morning. God, give them the eyes of faith and let them call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. Would you do that good work in our midst, we pray. Amen.